Hello again, and welcome to the second of Huddersfield Local History Society's 2021-22 season of online talks. Our speaker, Rob Vincent, has lived and worked here for more than 30 years and has made his home in Bolster Moor on the hills above the Colne Valley. He's now left us to follow his family and to start another chapter in his life north of the border in Scotland. He and Heather, his wife, were great walkers, and over the years with their children have explored every part of the valley and have worked to make sense of its unique landscape. In the process, I think it's probably true to say that they've both fallen in love with it. In a way, Rob's talk and the book he has written, which the Society is delighted to publish, are love letters to the valley. And this is a fond farewell. Rob.
Thank you for that introduction, Cyril. Welcome, everyone, to this talk on the history of the Colne Valley landscape. I'm Rob Vincent. I'm a long-term resident of the Colne Valley and one with an ever-deepening regard for that landscape. Long ago, I read a book that many of you will also know. It's W.G. Hoskins, The Making of the English Landscape. Once read, you will always be looking at what's around you with an eye to the history that brought about the current form of landscapes. And I've tried to apply that approach to the Colne Valley. It's been a very rewarding study. It's a strong and distinctive landscape, and one whose history is highly legible in its current form, particularly on the valley's hillsides. The valley bottom has its own strong history, particularly in the legacy of the Industrial Revolution, but that's a separate story. My plan for this session is to share with you some of my enthusiasm for the valley and some of the history that lies behind what you see today. I'm going to begin by unpicking its various elements, its field pattern and walls, its quarries, the effect of its economy on the settlement pattern, the legacy of non-conformism on the hillsides, its roads, tracks, railway, and canal, and its reservoirs. But the threads are just a means of analysis. It's the combination of all those things that makes up the history of the landscape of the Colne Valley. This image is a good place to start. It's the view from Holstone Moor on the north side of the valley, looking down Crimble Clough with the flat shelf of Bolster Moor towards the top on the left-hand side. What you first see is a landscape of grazed fields with a network of grey dry stone walls with woodland hanging over the steep sides of the clough itself. But look more closely and you will see that there are in fact two distinct field patterns here. There's a regular pattern with straight walls on the top of Bolster Moor. And then on the steeper sides of the valley itself, there are irregular fields with winding walls along the hillside. It's a reminder that the field patterns have evolved over the ages, and there is much more here than you might at first think. In fact, the oldest fields are not here at all. They're in the Wessenden Valley. This is a vaccary wall. Vaccaries were medieval catchment branches, often owned by monasteries, as this one was, but remote from them. There are several in the Marsden area, recorded in a 14th century document to be found in the West Yorkshire archives. Ancient walls are distinctive because they meander across outcrops with a base of large stones clear from the fields and then pile on top of them other stones, but without any coursing or infill. There are quite a few along the lower valley hillsides, if you look. This one is below Badger Gate on the south side of the valley along the Marsden to Melton Road. The large stones set up right at the base are known as orthostats. And this, in fact, is an orthostat wall. An orthostat wall indicates a very early field pattern. After the vaccaries, the earliest enclosures were mostly on the shoulders of the hillsides, where the early farmers cleared what are known as assarts from the woodland and scrub. They cleared boulders from the land and made orthostat walls, often roughly circular, because that's the shape which requires least effort. They built their homes among the assarts and raised their families, and over the generations, the original assart was often extended with further small fields taken in from the waste. This map is of Hay Farms, close to Holt Head, and it was made in the 18th century. But it shows a form which suggests an original assart. If you look at the rough ellipse in the middle of the map, that seems very likely to have been originally an assart brought in from the waste. And then the irregular fields to either side of it will have been added over the generations as the family succeeded and expanded. The pattern's still very much the same there today. If you walk along the path between the two walls to the right-hand side of the assart, you can see that almost nothing has changed over the centuries. In fact, there are lots of areas along the lower sides of the valley, particularly around the flatter shoulders, which are formed about two-thirds of the ways up the slopes, where the old field pattern is still very much in evidence. Many of you will know of the 16th century and 17th century manorial rolls, which are a rich source of information about the area as it was at the end of the medieval times. They contain many references to houses and hamlets that are still to be found. Shawfields, Boothbank, Wilberley, Woolroyd, Lawns, many others. You'll recognize these places as being almost all perched on the shoulders of the valley. And here they are, plotted on a modern Ordnance Survey map base. There's something else which tells you that these old fields, if you walk around, you will often find a goat post looking something like this. It's designed to close a gap with spars rather than a gate. And it was typical in the 17th century, and therefore a reminder that you're in a field pattern that has changed little over the centuries. There are one or two scattered amongst the irregular hillside fields along the Colne Valley. This one, I think, is just above westward on the north side. You also find other sorts of specialist enclosures along the valley sides. This is a pinfold, which you may well know. This is at Ainley Place. The picture is from shortly after it was restored. I'm afraid it's now more difficult to pick out amongst the undergrowth and the brambles, but it's still there. And the pinfold was there to keep stray animals on behalf of the community. And this one was actually managed by a man who lived higher up the valley side. Also, you'll find sheepfolds. Most of the sheepfolds have long gone and fallen back really into the hillside, but this is still evident. This is one near March Hague. In fact, there are two near March Hague. Indications of what was once there. The sheepfold would be for collecting the sheep on occasions through the year, for inspecting them, for sorting them. You can see the small chamber to the left of the fold would be where the shepherd would have taken individual sheep in to be looked at particularly. There's another sheepfold high in the Westerdon Valley. If you then go to the tops of the valley side, you'll find the fields are really quite different. They are larger, more rectilinear, and they're walled with much more regular walls, straight lines, maybe with sawn stone in neat courses. They're a landscape created by 19th century enclosures. This is Bolster Moor again, and it's part of the Golker Parliamentary Enclosure of 1823. You will perhaps know the Parliamentary Enclosures. This was a relatively late one, actually, and it's the only one which is actually in the valley. There's also one just over the watershed at into Scammerdon. But you can see how different they are in the regular form of the walls. These are a fill pattern which is first drawn on a map and then made rather than simply made on the ground following contours. They don't have to be parliamentary enclosures. This set of walls is actually at Stone Folds, which is on the north side of the valley above Marsden. So those are just a brief introduction to the different sorts of enclosure patterns there are in the valley. The next thing perhaps to chase down are the quarries from which all that stone was brought. They really give a rather dramatic emphasis to the network of stone-walled fields which holds the landscape together. This is Warlow. It's one of five really quite large quarries worked around Pule Hill and very active from the mid 19th century until the early 20th century, when there was an enormous hunger for stone, for the mills and the housing that came with the Industrial Revolution in the valley bottoms, and also further afield. There was Yorkshire stone from this period paving the streets of London. This was a highly mechanized quarry towards the end of its life, with machinery sawing the stone. But there were other much more modest quarries in Delft, really widely distributed through the valley. This one is just under the edge of Holstone Moor. And these were worked for long periods, sporadically, so that they would be worked as stone was required and then let go when there was less building around. And you'll find many, many of these along the upper parts of the hillsides. The stone cut from them was very often dressed on site. And there are some remains here, which are an indication of that. These are dressing sheds at Wart's Hill, one of two sets just under the top there. Not all the stone that was being taken from quarries and delves was building stone of any sort. This is a shot of the Gannister workings taken across the reservoir at Deer Hill. Now, the Gannister was actually a rather harder sandstone which was used to line furnaces, including some which were in operation in Meltham. There's something else that has set the form of the Colne Valley landscape. It has a very distinctive settlement pattern created by the dual economy which long existed of farming and domestic cloth making. It's a pattern of individual hamlets and farmsteads widely distributed along the valley sides with fields around them and dividing one from another, relatively few nucleated settlements along the Colne Valley hills. It's been long established. This is Daniel Defoe writing in 1724 on his long journey through England and describing what he found as he crossed the Pennines from Lancashire into Yorkshire. The side of the hills, which were very steep every way, was spread with houses, and that very thick. For the land being divided into small enclosures from 2 acres to 7 acres each, seldom more, every 3 or 4 pieces of land had a house belonging to it. You could see that almost at every house there was a tenter, and at almost every tenter a piece of cloth, or kersey, or shaloon. And as our road passed among them, wherever we passed any house, we found a rill of gutter of running water. And at every considerable house, there was a manufactory or workhouse. Then, as every clothier must keep a horse, perhaps two, to fetch and carry for the use of his manufacture, so every manufacturer generally keeps a cow or two or more for his family, and this employs the two or three or four pieces of enclosed land around his house, for they scarce sow corn enough for their cocks and hens. He was describing a dual economy that had already been established for a century or so as he rode by. It was most often a family business, with adults and children involved in carding and spinning the wool, weaving the cloth, taking it to the fulling mill to be scoured and washed, and then finishing the piece. They would also tend their small holding and their beasts. In good times, it seemed to offer a high quality of life. Watson's farming notes of 1775 reported that there was a constant supply of work, good wages, and plenty of most necessities of life. So I know not any country where, upon the whole, they live better. That wasn't always the case, of course. There were economic cycles and a deep depression, as well known, after the Napoleonic War. But over the longer term, there had been great strength in the market, and the textile trade had an international reach by the 18th century. It saw wool brought in from northern Germany and Silesia, and finished cloth exported through international networks of agents. You will know the scale and substance of the Halifax Peace Hall, but there was also a cloth hall built by the Ramsdens in Huddersfield in 1766. And by the 1830s, it had 600 regular traders. It's where the Sainsbury's now is, at the top of town in Huddersfield. The dual economy remained strong and productive into the mid-19th century, when the domestic textile production was replaced by industrialization in the valley bottoms. But the mills and terraces that were built were not on the hillsides, they were in the bottoms of the valleys, which has left the hillsides with essentially a fixed landscape, which goes back to before the mid-19th century. Here is a typical section of the Ordnance Survey map of the valley made in the mid-19th century. It shows a well-distributed pattern of houses and small holdings. And it's the same pattern that you will recognize today, effectively set by the turn of the 18th to 19th centuries. And then if you look at the individual houses, they too reflect the dual economy. Lathe houses, which combine a dwelling with a barn and a minstrel under a single roof, but with separate entrances, are to be found in several places along the hillsides. And many of them have the runs of south-facing mullioned windows, which allowed maximum light onto the weaving looms. This particular one is at Stubbing, on the road into Marsden from Slough. Newing Farm, where I lived, also had that form, and it was built over a spring, and there was a single-storey dye house at the rear. For a while, after the growth of the valley bottom populations, as the mills were built in the second half of the 19th century, the farm was producing more than the domestic cloth production, and that was sustaining the hillside small holdings. There was a strong market for milk and eggs, which were perishable and had to be sourced fairly locally. A neighbour of ours at Clough Head remembers a delivery run throughout the valley and over to Saddleworth from his hen sheds. We have talked about the valley's settlement pattern, but as you stand on the hillsides and look around, you notice something else. There will often be a chapel in view, sitting with a quiet dignity in and amongst the houses. This one is at Sunnybank, at the Baptist Chapel on Bolster Moor. The story of nonconformism in the valley is well worth a talk in its own right. It reflects the strength of the communities that were confident and strong in their habits of independent thought, self-reliance, and self-organization. But to tell that story briefly, the starting point is actually in Sandine Nook, where a Baptist community first took root in the 17th century. Until the Act of Toleration, at the beginning of the reign of William and Mary, they met in a barn. But then they built the first chapel in the mid-18th century. The first chapel in the Colne Valley was at Pole Moor, first built in the 1790s and then later extended. From there, the movement expanded rapidly, partly with the population expansion of the valley, but perhaps also because the Anglican Church in the 18th and early 19th century was very much associated with the old order and with the establishment. And it took a while for it to respond to the vitality, vigor of the Baptist movement. There were links, of course, with the social and political movements of the early 19th century. The Pall Mall Chapel features very strongly in Benno Bills, the novel written by D.F.E. Sykes about Luddites. Well worth the read if you can get hold of it. It brings to life a congregation that would walk several miles across the hillsides to attend the chapel each Sunday. By the end of the 19th century, there were 9 Baptist chapels along the hillside on the south side of the valley. Strikingly, all but one, the very latest of them, had been built just outside the boundaries of the Dartmouth estate. And that tells a story. The estate colluded with the Church of England in opposing the growth of the Baptist movement and of independent and radical thought in general. Here is a map showing the location of the Baptist chapels in the Colne Valley. The growth was due to the very appeal of such thought and by population growth more generally, but the number of chapels also was also affected by fierce schisms within the congregations, generally between the strict Calvinist Baptists, who saw salvation as a God-given expectation for the elect, and the Fullerists, or Arminians, who took a much more open approach to salvation through good deeds and to the expansion of congregations through the conversion of outsiders. The original Pall Mall congregation was Calvinist. The pastor, Pastor Webster, described those who spoke of salvation through repentance and amended life as rotten, weak-minded, illogical, benighted, corrupt seducers from the faith. It was fierce and uncompromising stuff, but quite typical of the time. The Baptist chapels remain strong in the community, and there are also strong elements in the landscape. This is the largest of them at Scapegoat Hill, built in 1879 to replace a smaller chapel on the High Street. There are just as many Methodist churches and chapels in the valley. Now, this one is Golka Methodist Church, but the history is rather different. Wesley was an ordained Anglican all his life, and until the mid-19th century, Methodism was a revitalizing movement within the Church of England, which had by that stage become somewhat moribund. Wesley was an indefatigable preacher, committed to saying what he found to be somewhat, saving what he found to be somewhat worryingly dissolute populations. You may know his reaction to the local population when he made his first visit to the area in 1757. "I rode over the mountains to Huddersfield, a wilder people I never saw in England. The men, women, and children filled the streets and seemed just ready to devour us." But whatever he found and what he thought of the local population, it didn't seem to dissuade him from his cause, and he was indefatigable, preaching both in the open air and in Anglican churches. But after his death, from the mid-19th century onwards, Methodism separated from the Church of England and built its own churches and chapels. But unlike the Baptist chapels on the hills, they were in the communities along the valley bottom. This is a set in Linthwaite, where it dominates the centre of the village. There's a chapel here, a Sunday school, and a hall. As the 19th century progressed, the Church of England pushed back against the growth of nonconformism. Here as elsewhere, there was a movement to rebuild and expand the churches in the main settlements along the valley floor, particularly after the Napoleonic War. There was also an attempt to recapture some of the communities on the hillsides. There were missions established at Shred and at Westwood Edge on the south side of the valley, and on Lingard's Lane on the north side. And then there was a Sunday school built at Holdhead. Shred is still in use, I think, but Holdhead is now a private house. So far, we have explored the field pattern, settlements, and chapels of the valley hillsides, all linked by their particular nature and economy based on the two pillars of domestic cloth making and small-scale farming. But there are two further distinctive features of the Colne Valley landscape to bring out before we stand back to see it as a whole. They are its transport connections and its water supplies. As to connections, the valley has an extraordinary network of those at two distinct levels. The first stems from its role as a corridor. It is the eastern end of what has always been a major corridor across the Pennines to Lancashire and Cheshire. That route will have been in use for millennia, but even the elements that remain visible in the landscape reach back to Roman times. This is a map of the route of the Roman road from Castleshaw on the far side of Stanage to Slack near Outlane. The blue dotted line shows what was long assumed to be the route along Stanage itself and then turning east along what is now the A640. But the red is the actual route. It was a route established by the Huddersfield and District Archaeological Association over many years of informed speculation and then careful confirmatory investigations on the ground. Here it is, running over Moorside Edge. If you look carefully, you can just see the shadow of the raised roadbed, known as the Agar to the Romans, between the two white lines. In fact, if you stand on Rockingstones Hill and look down on a sunny winter's day, with the light coming towards the evening, you'll still be able to see that line of the raised agar across the fields around the Crimea causeways. After the Romans had left, the cross-Pennine routes were sustained, and they were recorded in the monastic records. They were particularly important as part of networks of tracks which were used to bring salt from Cheshire. And then as the domestic textile trade grew, they became peckhorse routes to markets. At this stage, they began to be paved over soft ground, and you'll still find lines of causeway or quarry stones in some places. This particular set is above Lingard's Wood on the south side of the valley. By the 17th century, they had become much better engineered packhorse tracks. You will know well, I think, the packhorse bridge at Eastergate below the moor. The other image on this slide shows the green lane which ran from Slowit Hall up to Copt Hill and then through Merredale before ascending to the lower Royal George near Pole Moor. These were the arterial routes of their time. An act of 1698 required that they be properly signposted at all major junctions. And here are two of the guideposts which are raised. The one on the left is at the lower Royal George, and it directs you to Halifax, Huddersfield, and Scammerden. And the one on the right is a similar guidepost. This one is at Longwood Common, not far away. But it was the growth of trade from the mid-18th century onwards that led to the most impressive developments along the corridor. In the following decades, the valley saw the development of two turnpike routes, one of which followed three successive lines, and then the canal, and then the railway. The turnpikes came first, part of an extraordinary period of transport development, as industrialization got underway and moving goods required wheeled carts rather than pack horses. This is a view from Pule Hill looking west, and it shows the first Wakefield to Ossulands turnpike route. That's the one which is now under the metal road running from bottom left to midway up the right-hand side of the picture. And then it shows the second of the routes of that turnpike. That's the track which you can make out running from the same point, but up to the horizon, just to the right of the centre, where it goes through the Stanage cutting itself, part of the third route, which actually skirted the north side of Pule Hill up to the Stanage cutting. Next came the canal. The problematic early story of the canal company and its ultimately successful tunnel through Stanage has been very well told by others, and it's essentially a valley bottom matter. But its ventilation shafts make a striking addition to the top of the valley landscape. On the left are the shafts at Pule Holes, and on the right, the engine house by Redwick Reservoir. The railway followed with three more tunnels under Stanage, so that in a period of about 70 years, we had turnpikes, canal, and railway all developed through the valley and following essentially the same routes as the Romans and the monastic salt carriers of early ages. That's the valley as a corridor, but there's a second level of connections that is just as important in the valley. There's a great richness of local tracks joining hamlet to hamlet, hamlet to chapel, workshop to market, farm to grazing on the moors, quarry to highway, and some are particularly well made. This one connects Binedge to the route up the Wessenden Valley. And this is one of the walled gates that allowed farmers to take the beasts up to graze on the moor. This particular one is near Holt Head, but there are several in the valley. There are a few landscapes where the wall tracks and other connections are such strong features, and few where they offer such a rich network of walking routes through the hillsides. The final important element in the valley landscape is water. There are 14 reservoirs in the valley, a very high number even by Pennine standards, and there are many more mill dams, troughs, and leads. There's a circular logic to their presence. The availability of soft water falling on the hills, stored in the sandstone aquifers, and then flowing from constant springs where the sandstone sits above impervious mudstones. That was a key factor in the development of the textile economy. And the burgeoning demand of that economy meant a thirst for more and more water storage. When the economy was on a domestic scale, it was simple channeled flows from springs that met the need. You will often come across a well-made culvert and a trough by the trackside if you walk through the valley. It might remind you of the rills and channels mentioned by Defoe, writing centuries earlier. This one is at Bradshaw. But as the water-powered mills developed, there was a need for larger holding reservoirs. The first in the valley was Cupwith, high on the moor, and feeding early mills in Merridale. Cupwith was built in the 18th century. It was then the planning of the canal that brought several more. The owners of the then existing mills were keen to have the canal down the valley, but they were also anxious because they drew their water from the Colne and were anxious that the canal itself would divert their supplies. As a result, a clause was written into the Canal Act requiring the canal fees to be entirely separate from the valley. It was to be drawn from reservoirs. To that end, March Hague, redwood, redbrook, black moss and swellens were all built high up on the moors. Hilltop was rather lower, and Tunnel End and Sparth were constructed as regulating reservoirs along the line of the canal itself. By the mid-19th century, the industries of Huddersfield and the valley had greatly expanded, and with them an almost insatiable thirst, from the mill processes themselves as much as from the burgeoning population. The Huddersfield Water Commissioners were established in 1827, and they built their first reservoirs in the Longwood Valley. But by 1840, they were looking further afield, and the first Westernham Valley was built in that year. This Westernham Reservoir was built in that year. Several more were planned, although there was then a pause in construction after a run of dam failures in mid-century. You all know the bilberry failure in the Holme Valley that killed 80 people, and 240 were killed when the Dale Dyke Dam near Sheffield failed in 1864. This is Hilltop Reservoir, perched above the centre of Slough. You can appreciate the sense of apprehension by those living and working below its dam. But the demand for further water supply remained unrelenting. It was one of the key drivers for the formation of the Huddersfield Corporation in 1868. And that's well covered in the recent book edited by David Griffiths. Reservoirs at Deer Hill, Blackmorefoot, and a further three down the Western Valley followed. Butterley was the last we completed, seen here with Blakely above it. There was then a long pause until the Scammerdon Reservoir was completed in 1970. The reservoirs often catch the changing light in the valley. This is Blackmore Foot, taken from just under Holstone Moor. And it looks rather like the Eye of Sauron, I always think, if you know your Lord of the Rings, sitting apparently on top of a hill. In fact, it and Deer Hill, further along the valley's watershed between Meltham and Marsden, are fed by a very well-made set of cut-off catchment channels which stretch round and along the east side of the Western Valley. They are a further line of accomplished engineering high above the turnpikes, canal and railway below. It's time to sum up. You will appreciate that although this talk has teased out aspects of the valley landscape, they all knit together in one landscape as we see it. What connects them is a shared history, a longer one than is perhaps immediately obvious, but one dominated by the effects of a dual economy of domestic cloth making and farming that resulted in a distinctive settlement pattern on the hillsides and the chapels, tracks and water supplies that stemmed from it. I hope you will share my enthusiasm for the valley and for the rewards of exploring it and digging into the factors that made its landscape. There is so much satisfaction in discovering how it came to be. If you are interested, you might want to look at the book, which with help from colleagues in the Huddersfield Local History Society has just reached the point of being published, Colne Valley, A History of a Pennine Landscape. But for now, I just want to say thank you very much for watching this talk on the history of the Colne Valley landscape.
Thank you, Rob. During the pandemic, for a lot of us, walking has become more important than ever before. I was born in the Colne Valley, grew up in Slathwaite and have lived in Goker for more than 50 years. For me, Rob's book has been an inspiration to get out and discover those parts of the valley I've never seen before, and I intend to carry on exploring. If you're keen to get your boots on and to get out on the hills, Rob's book is a wonderful guide. We're hoping to have it for sale in a number of local outlets, Colne Valley Museum and Waterstones in particular, but that may take time. So if you want to get a copy now and start exploring your valley straight away, then you can order it by visiting our website. Thanks again to Rob. Thanks to you all for joining us. Until next time, goodbye.